Hello everyone, welcome to MBBS classes. Myself, Dr. Hanifa. Today in this video, I'll be talking on chronic otitis media or COM. To begin with, let us see the certain terminologies. Chronic otitis media or COM, it is an intractable pathology of the middle ear cleft with permanent defect of the tympanic membrane of duration greater than 3 months. The defect in the tympanic membrane could be in the form of retraction pockets, atelectasis, or perforation. We call the condition as chronic suppurative otitis media when this chronic otitis media it presents with persistent otorrhea. So COM, when it is associated with persistent otorrhea, it is called as CSOM. Chronic otitis media is classified based on the presence or the absence of cholesteatoma. So there are two varieties. One is the COM or the chronic otitis media without cholesteatoma, and second group is chronic otitis media with cholesteatoma. The first group, the chronic otitis media without cholesteatoma, it is often also called as tubotympanic type of disease. The reason it is known as tubotympanic disease because it involves the part of the middle ear cleft adjacent to the eustachian tube and the mesotympanum. In this disease, the mucosal factor plays a role. What happens in the tubotympanic disease is the inflammatory changes are irreversible in nature and they are confined within the middle ear and the mastoid. In the other group of chronic otitis media with cholesteatoma, the main factor which is playing role is the cholesteatoma. And this cholesteatoma is responsible for all the erosions of the bone. It is called attico-antral disease as it involves the attic region and the mastoid antrum. Out of these two diseases, attico-antral disease, due to the association with the cholesteatoma, it is associated mostly with the complications and it is considered to be unsafe type of CSOM. There are certain risk factors, or we can see the etiologies for the chronic otitis media. Let us see one by one. The first is the history of recurrent acute otitis media. It is seen that in few of the cases of acute otitis media which fails to resolve, they lead to the development of chronic otitis media as a sequelae. Family history, especially in the parents with the history of CSOM, is another risk factor which has to be considered while taking history of the patients. Next is the ascending route of infection via the eustachian tube. From the eustachian tube, the infection can travel from the certain areas, from tonsils, adenoids, and infected sinuses. Another important risk factor is the allergy, and there are certain group of patients belonging to the poor socioeconomic status, and those children who spend most of their time in the crowded daycare settings. Because of the overcrowding, what happens? There is a cross-infection between these group of patients and they are at more risk for developing chronic otitis media. Let us see the pathogenesis of the chronic otitis media without cholesteatoma. So we have seen these are the risk factors for the development of chronic otitis media. Due to the recurrent infection, whether the infection is ascending from through the eustachian tube or whether it is a sequelae of the acute otitis media, whatever reason may be, it leads to the irreversible inflammatory changes in the middle ear and the mastoid. As a result of which, there is a disruption of the aeration of the middle ear cleft due to the edema and due to the granulation tissue. As we all know, the middle ear cleft is divided into several compartments by the mucosal folds. And these different mucosal compartments, they get aeration through the otitis ad antrum. We have seen in the anatomy classes. So what happens when there will be the inflammatory changes within this middle ear cleft, there will be formation of granulation tissue. Due to this edema and the granulation tissue, it can lead to chronic otomastoiditis and certain pathological findings. So the pathological findings in chronic otitis media without cholesteatoma are, will get granulation tissue in the middle ear cleft. There will be perforation of the pars tensa part of the tympanic membrane. The perforation gets permanent when the margins of the perforation gets epithelized. Then due to this granulation tissue, there in some cases we may get the ossicular changes. Remind, in the cases of chronic otitis media without cholesteatoma, the ossicular damage, especially the long process of incurs, is at risk of developing the avascular necrosis. In these cases, the ossicular damage is due to the granulation tissue. The fourth pathological finding, in some cases, we may get tympanosclerosis. This tympanosclerosis, these are the chalky-like deposits which may be seen over the tympanic membrane or around the ossicular chain. What happens as a result of chronic otitis media in the post-inflammation stage, there occurs hyalinization and the calcification of the subepithelial connective tissue. So these chalky white deposits may be either seen over the remnant tympanic membrane, they may be present over the promontory, around the ossicles, tendons, and around the oval and the round window. So whenever these tympanosclerotic patches are present around the ossicular chain, it may interfere in the conduction of the sounds and it can lead to greater degree of hearing loss in particular patients. So the pathological findings, I repeat, it could be granulation tissue, permanent perforation of the pars tensa, ossicular chain damage, and lastly tympanosclerosis. So perforation is an important finding in chronic otitis media. So let us see the different types of perforation. Perforations are usually classified as per the location. So in the so let us just recapitulate the anatomy of tympanic membrane. This is the anterior malleolar fold. This is the posterior malleolar fold, and the part below is the pars tensa, and the part above is the pars flaccida. In chronic otitis media without cholesteatoma, the perforation is always present in the pars tensa. The location of the tympanic membrane perforation, it could be anterior perforation or posterior perforation in relation to the handle of malleus. This is the handle of malleus. So we can see here there is a perforation or the defect of the pars tensa anterior to the handle of malleus. So it is an anterior perforation. If a perforation is present behind the handle of malleus, it will be posterior perforation. Then the perforation which is present inferior to the handle of malleus is called as inferior perforation. Now, what is subtotal perforation? Subtotal perforations, these are the very large perforations of the pars tensa with a very thin rim of remaining tympanic membrane, plus one thing is the annulus is intact in case of subtotal perforation, because there is one variant known as marginal perforations. What happens in marginal perforation? These are large perforations and they involve the annulus of the tympanic membrane and it reaches the sulcus tympanicus. So it is seen that in cases of chronic otitis media without cholesteatoma, these marginal perforations, they are riskier type of perforation and they are often associated with complications. So when we do the otoscopic examination of the patients, we have to know the location of the perforation, the status of the tympanic annulus, and the any sort of any other bony erosions. Since we know that the chronic otitis media is caused by the repeated infection of the middle ear cleft, so let us look into the microbiology of the chronic otitis media. Both aerobic and anaerobic bacteria are involved in it, but most commonly which organisms which are responsible are the aerobic bacteria. Out of these, the most commonly seen are Pseudomonas, Proteus group, Staphylococcus aureus, E. coli and Klebsiella species. In some cases, the other offending organisms could be anaerobic bacteria like bacteroids and the anaerobic streptococci. Chronic otitis media without cholesteatoma. The two variants are permanent perforation syndrome and persistent mucosal disease. These two variants, they are identified clinically based on the otoscopic examination and based on the history of the patients. So now let us see one by one. In cases of permanent perforation syndrome, the defect will be seen in the pars tensa of the tympanic membrane. The defect of the pars tensa of the tympanic membrane is common in both permanent perforation syndrome and persistent mucosal disease. But the difference is that when the ear is dry, when there is no infection, in those cases, the mucous membrane of the medial tympanic wall, that is the promontory, it appears pale pink or gray in color. As we can see here, this is the otoscopic image of a patient of chronic otitis media. The ear is completely dry. We can see here, this is the tympanic membrane. This is a posterior perforation. We can see here, the malleus handle is not seen. This is the incudostipedial joint. This is the round window. And if we look into the middle ear mucosa, once there is a perforation, the wall which is seen of the middle ear is the promontory or the medial wall of the middle ear cavity. So we can see here the color of the middle ear cavity is appearing gray in color. So there is no edema or infection of the middle ear cavity. We can also see here another pathological finding called tympanosclerosis. In the same patient, we are getting two findings. One is perforation, one is tympanosclerosis. So tympanosclerosis, it appears as a chalky white deposit. If you look here, this is a remnant tympanic membrane. The color is not transparent. It is chalky white in color. Moreover, in cases of permanent perforation syndrome, there will not be any granulation tissues or keratinization. How do they present? The presentation is, there will be history of on and off ear discharge. The type of discharge is usually mucoid, because we know that there are plenty of mucus secreting glands and goblet cells in the middle ear cavity, or mucopurulent discharge for the long duration. Regarding history taking of ear discharge, you can go through our video for the ear discharge. Next clinical presentation is hearing loss. There will be difficulty in hearing. The type of hearing loss in this group of patients is usually conductive type of loss. But in few of the cases, due to long-standing perforation, due to repeated ear infection, there may be cochlear damage due to the toxins released from the bacteria. In those cases, there will be a mixed type of hearing loss. Mixed loss, that means combination of conductive hearing loss and the sensorineural hearing loss. The degree of hearing loss, it also tells us about the status of the disease. So now let us see the impression we get by different degrees of hearing loss. A hearing loss between 25 to 40 dB, it suggests that the patient's ossicular chain system is intact. Whenever the hearing loss is more than 45 dB, it suggests us that there might be certain presence of additional lesions like tympanosclerosis. We have seen that tympanosclerosis may be present around the ossicular joint also. So whenever these tympanosclerotic pathological changes are present, it can lead to ossicular fixation or ankylosis of the malleo-incudal joint. So whenever the degree of hearing loss is more than 45 dB, think of and look for the additional lesions like tympanosclerosis in the middle ear cavity during the microscopic examination. So we have to correlate the audiograms with the microscopic examinations also. In cases of hearing loss more than 60 dB, it means that there is some disruption of the ossicular chain, which usually happens due to the destruction of long process of incus, due to the inflammatory changes and due to the presence of granulation tissue in the chronic otitis media without cholesteatoma. Now, this persistent mucosal disease, it is the second variant of the chronic otitis media. What happens in the persistent mucosal disease is that the mucous membrane is always active. That means the mucous membrane of the whole medullary cleft is involved to a greater and lesser extent. It is edematous, it is inflamed, and the ear is always discharging. These type of persistent mucosal disease, again, they are three subtypes: tubal type, tympanic type, and tympanomastoid type. So in tubal types, how will we know? The tubal type means the part of the ear which is present in the anterior part. That means anterior mesotympanum in correlation with the eustachian tube. So the tubal type is when the perforation is seen in the anterior part with profuse mucopurulent discharge. What does it suggest? It suggests chronic infection of the eustachian tube and peritubal and hypotympanic cells. So whenever we get a discharging ear with the perforation in the anterior part of the tympanic membrane, we have to look for the disease in the adenoids, which suggests that the infection is getting transmitted up through the eustachian tube. In the second variety of the tympanic type, there will be a large defect of the pars tensor with retraction of the handle of malleus. In the tympanic variety, what we see is that the exposed middle ear mucosa or the mucosa of the promontory will be edematous, inflamed, and hyperplastic. And the history will be of persistent, either persistent discharge or recurrent otitis media. In the third variety, the tympanomastoid type, the mastoid ear cells are also involved, and in this group, there is a chance of developing acquired cholesteatoma. And these group of patients, they don't respond to oral toileting, and sometimes we may have to do a cortical mastoidectomy in this group of patients. In the last group, tympanomastoid type may need cortical mastoidectomy. So if we look into the otoscopic examination, we can see here, this is a perforation. We can see here the middle ear mucosa is congested, it is edematous, it is reddish in color, and few discharge, it is having wet look. Now let us compare the tympanic membrane between the two subtypes. So you can see here the permanent perforation type, it appears as a silent disease. That means there is a perforation, but the perforation is dry, the middle ear mucosa is gray, it is not active. But in case of mucosal disease, it is inflamed, the middle ear mucosa is edematous, and there is discharge. So otoscopic examination along with the history, it helps us to divide between these two variants. So whenever we get a case of chronic otitis media, how to approach these patients? First and important is history. After history taking, we have to do the otoscopic examination. Otoscopic examination will tell us about the type of perforation, location of perforation, knowledge about the margins, size of the perforation, and also about the middle ear mucosa. Next, microscopic examination must be done in all the cases. The additional information we get by microscopic examination is about the status of the ossicular chain, whether there is any tympanosclerotic foci around the ossicular chain, whether there is any ossicular chain disruption. Microscopic examination helps us to look into the details about the other pathological findings like granulation tissues, any mucosal polyps or adhesions in the middle ear mucosa. If there is any ear discharge, the sample should always be sent for Gram staining and culture in sensitivity. Whenever a patient is presenting with chronic otitis media, not only the ear, the other is adjacent areas like nose, paranasal sinuses, nasopharynx, and oral cavity must be examined to rule out the diseases like tonsillitis, enlarged adenoids, adenoiditis, and sinusitis. Because in presence of the diseases of the adjacent sites, if they are not taken care of, the ear will never be dry. Coming to the audiological test, the first basic test we have to do is the tuning fork test, which will help us to know about the type of hearing loss or sometimes the degree of hearing loss. Next, we have to do the pure tone audiometry. Radiological test in cases of, especially in cases of persistent mucosal disease, we have to advise mastoid X-ray. When we do the mastoid X-ray, it is usually sclerotic without any bony destructions and there will be clouding of mastoid air cells. In patients with nasal symptoms, oral symptoms and other associated clinical features, the other X-rays which may be advised is the X-ray of paranasal sinuses, adenoids, and especially in cases of bilateral CSOM. In cases of chronic otitis media, the main aim of treatment is, first is to control the infection and to produce a dry ear. Because until and unless the ear is not dry, it cannot be undertaken to surgery. The next aim of treatment is to improve the hearing by doing the surgery at a later stage once the ear is dry. Now let us see the medical management. Medical management, it aims to eradicate infection and it helps to produce the dry ear. The different ways of creating the dry ear is oral toileting. Oral toileting means by clearing up the ear discharge, and it can be done either by dry mopping with the cotton swabs or by suction cleaning under the microscopic visualization. Then topical antibiotics. After oral toileting, the topical antibiotics are advised as per the culture sensitivity report to take care of the local infection. Systemic antibiotics, they don't have the much role, but sometimes it is needed in acute exacerbation of the disease. Patient is advised to follow certain precautions like avoid swimming and avoid entry of water into the ear. There is a great role of surgery in CSOM. The main aim is to augment the hearing loss, augment the hearing by doing tympanoplasty. So what is tympanoplasty? Tympanoplasty, it is the closure of the tympanic membrane defect. There are different methods of doing tympanoplasty by using different grafts. I am not going into the details of tympanoplasty, so we'll discuss in some other videos. The advantage of doing tympanoplasty is, first of all, it restores hearing. Second is, it prevents recurrent infections and complications like tympanosclerosis and the development of cochlear loss. In few of the cases, especially in the tympanomastoid type of disease, where there is an involvement of the mastoid air cells, in cases of the chronic ear discharge not responding to the conservative medical management, in those cases we have to do cortical mastoidectomy. In patients with the adenotonsillar hypertrophy or adenoiditis or recurrent tonsillitis, which is a source of ascending infection to the ear, in those cases they must undergo adenotonsillectomy, and it is indicated in children with persistent mucosal disease, mainly of tubal variety. With this, I come to an end of this video. Thank you for watching this video.